are in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen. You may be seated.
All right, again, we want to welcome you this evening to our evening service. And we have a guest tonight that will be with us in just a minute to share their ministry and minister to us, Tim and Rachel and Dean. Just a couple quick announcements. I want to remind you, let you know, we had our business meeting this past Wednesday, our quarterly business meeting. The financial report is public, and that's on the back table for anyone that wants it. And I want to say it is a blessing to have. We were thrown into this digital age kicking and screaming. But when it comes to business meetings, being able to incorporate it on Zoom is very sweet. No problem with a quorum, which we used to really struggle with. That has been a big blessing. And of course, those of you at home that are members probably received the report, the financial report, but it's there for all to see. You can see, you know, how we spend our money, and pray for us that God would meet the needs of this ministry. Once again, I want to remind you about the Men's Conference. Biblical Family Ministries has been hosting the Men's Conference for many, many years, decades, I would say. Pastor Griffith, as you know, is my pastor. And recently, we've had the Men's Conference at his son Craig's church. And Craig, as you know, was diagnosed with cancer and died in such a quick time. And so you pray for Open Door Baptist Church. Pastor John Bateman is now the pastor, and he's a dear friend as well from our days in Westchester. But that ends up being a blessing now because the Men's Conference is going to be out of Chads Ford Baptist Church, which is so much closer. And I hope you can go. There's brochures on the back table. I think there's enough. I printed many. You could take three copies per family. There's that many brochures. But that's November 12th and 13th. You do need to sign up separately with Biblical Family Ministries, and also with the if you're going to stay the night at the motel that they recommend, which we would hope would be better than the one we had in the past. All right. Again, it's a privilege to have Tim and Rachel and Dean. They've been with the Wilds for a while now. They're going to come and share with you. He's going to come, and I don't know when you want to have her come up. But what a very precious couple. When my daughter worked at the Wilds, she got to know them, and she spoke very highly of them. Of course, she speaks highly of everyone at the Wilds. But there's probably a reason for that. So, Tim, why don't you come and minister, Rachel?
All right. Well, thank you for welcoming us. A number of you, you know, I said, hey, my name's Tim. And you said, well, you've been here before, right? I said, yeah, well, it's been a couple of years. But, yes, we have been here before. So, good memories. Thanks for welcoming us. Rachel and I get to work with the Wilds, but their international side of things, camps abroad. And so what we get to do is we help missionaries and national pastors around the world start their own youth camps. So these are people that are saying, hey, we want to use camp to reach the teens in our community. We want to use camp to reach the teens in our churches and serve them better with discipleship programs and opportunities. And we think camp's a great way to do that. Can you help us figure out how? And so with Camps Abroad, that's what we get to do. What we're passionate about is enabling churches on every continent to reach the hearts and the minds of teens through life-altering camp experiences. And we do want to reach both the heart and the mind of young people. We want to reach the mind with facts, things that are true about God, things that are true about God's word that never change. So, hey, here's attributes of God. Here are commands from God's word. Here's Bible principles, Bible promises. These are just things that are true. It's truth regardless of what the world says. But it's not just about inserting facts as though it's a sterilized classroom environment. But we also want to reach their hearts. And camp is a great opportunity to connect young people with some slightly older young people who love them and care about them and want to show the love of Christ to them. And so we get to reach both the hearts and the minds in that way. Camp's a great opportunity for that. Now, some of you are saying, okay, that's interesting and all, but you said something I don't quite agree with or I'm skeptical about. Every continent? Okay, every continent except one? Antarctica? Anybody? Okay. Yeah, no, we have not been to Antarctica. We're not making that claim, so I don't know how you want to footnote that, but it just makes it longer to say every continent except Antarctica or every inhabited continent. But once there's a good local church there with a good population of teenagers and they want to use camp to reach that community in Antarctica, we'll be glad to help. And I'm sure it'll be a snow camp. Rachel and I have been with the Wilds for a little over 3 years, and God's allowed us to work with Camps Abroad. We actually met working at the Wilds of New England, and then Rachel finished up her schooling, and we went to work with Camps Abroad right after that. Matt Collier is our director. He's part-time with Camps Abroad, full-time with the Wilds. Dan Brooks, also full-time with the Wilds, part-time with Camps Abroad. And then Abigail is our secretary. She just started recently, and I will get a picture at some point. But then Rachel and I are the only full-time with Camps Abroad, and so they brought us on a couple years ago because they said, hey, we see the needs, the opportunities, and we just don't have the availability to help all the groups that are requesting help. Could you join our team? And we said yes. Not that fast. Why camping? Why do we do camp at all? Well, God uses the tool of Christian camping to reach young people all over the world. Of the people here, have any of you benefited from the ministry of a Christian camp here in the U.S.? Anybody? Okay. Some, yeah. Rachel and I would say the exact same thing, that God has used camp in our lives. And this is consistently true many, many places in the U.S. and around the world, that young people come to camp, or even adults, you know, as a family camp or a weekend retreat. It's an opportunity to hear the word of God without going immediately back to your normal routine, but then to think about it in a couple different ways. Time for personal Bible study built into the schedule with camp, one-on-one discussions. So all these opportunities that camp brings, and I'll share a little more about that, but it's just a unique opportunity to hear the word of God and concentrate on it and focus on it in a way that's a little bit different from other opportunities that we have. Camps Abroad has been in existence for about 20 years now, a little over, and in that time has sent 150 teams to more than 50 countries on 6 continents and helped really about 100 ministries at this point. And when I mentioned a team there, that's anywhere from 1, 2, 3 people going to a location, helping them figure out how to do something sustainable, and then returning to the U.S. So it's not as though we have 150 teams sent, spread out all over the world serving right now. It's that they go and return and go and return. And so that could be, you know, the same people represented multiple times. And thankfully, all those teams have returned. And so we don't have anybody stuck out in the world right now. Up next, I've got a short video that'll show you a little bit more of what camp looks like around the world.
Here I am. When we first started Camps Abroad back in 2001, a number of churches had contacted us asking for help, and they didn't really know how to reach young people. We knew camping is an incredible tool, both for salvation and spiritual growth. The goal was just to be a help to those pastors, the missionaries, who may have excellent ministry training, but they don't really have that specific niche of camping. We are passionate about helping churches reach those young people. And so our heart has always been to give them the Word of God and to see God transform their lives.
Without Camps Abroad's help, we might have eventually figured it out, but it would have been a really bumpy road. Camps Abroad has a strong emphasis on doing things orderly. That's what I think is one of their greatest strengths in helping these international camps really work at a much higher level of excellence in organization, planning, execution, program that has been very invaluable for us.
I really wanted to start a camp here in Bangladesh because nobody ever tried camping in Bangladesh. So my vision and my dream was that I want to show them the real peace. I want to introduce them with the Prince of Peace who gave us peace here in the earth.
Filipinos love camping in general. I believe that suits the Filipinos' culture. Outdoors is one of the best ways to reach the youth now because they're so focused on their gadgets. Of course, internet, social media, and online gaming. So I believe camping just takes them away from those things, and for them to hear the Word of God over and over and over again, camping is one of the best tools that we could reach the next generation for Christ.
I think it's a place where in 1 week the Word of God is preached and taught, and you get more of it than you get in 2 or 3 months in a local church. To see young people come and sit under that, and it's a balance of ministry that in a sense allows me to do the things that I think God's called me to do. And I think it's a tremendous help to local churches throughout Peru.
In Malawi a few years ago, there were a number of pastors that were working as counselors. It was so fun to watch them get involved in big ball, the different games, and they had as much fun as the young people. At the end of the week, they grouped up around me to give testimony of how the week had changed their lives. They said in their churches, they'd always looked over young people. Now they understood that they could have a vibrant ministry with that group of people from their churches.
Camping provides built-in discipleship opportunities for these local churches, and especially the counselors. As they get in with the young people, they get to know them, they're building relationships with them. It is just a built-in opportunity to share God's Word with them on a personal basis. They get to eat with them, they sleep in the same rooms with them, they play games with them. It's just a full package. The young people really open up.
Many young people really don't know where they are going. They have no hope at all. We want to see the campers grow in the Lord. If they are not saved, they will be saved. We want God to be glorified through this camp, and we want God Himself to work here.
Ultimately, it comes back to God's Word. God's Word is what changes lives, and camping is an opportunity for them to hear the Bible in a way that they can relate to. We deal with subjects that they are dealing with on a daily basis. We are able to really give them God's truth in a way that they connect with. And it gets them away to a place where they can actually focus on what God has for them. God has really used this ministry in a profound way. The exciting part about it for me is that many of these camps are continuing on without our involvement. The camps that we work with are not big. There's just a lot of faithful folks ministering the Word of God in hard to reach places. Our goal is to come in and give them the tools that they need, and then we're going to phase out as soon as we can. We're going to move the scaffolding on to another place and help somebody else. And we're just seeing God really multiply those efforts, and we're looking forward to seeing what He does in the days ahead as well.
God's ministry today is centered on local churches. That's His program. We want to help local churches in Peru, primarily through the preaching and teaching of the Word. Helping not just one local church, but really all the local churches here. Camp ministry just makes a lot of sense.
When we travel around to churches in the States, we often ask how many people have been impacted by camp, either salvation or major life-changing decision. And it is routinely the vast majority of people that we are speaking to. All we're doing with Camps Abroad is taking that incredible ministry of camping and we're exporting it around the world. God does the same incredible work because it's the Word of God that transforms lives. It's the gospel that changes people. And we have the privilege of seeing that happen all over the world in all different settings and all different cultures. And God is still doing a great work through camping.
All right, so that's a little bit of a picture of what that looks like, how camp has benefited some of those local churches around the world. And a lot of those camps are continuing. This is a bit of where Camps Abroad has been. But of those camps that Camps Abroad has served over the years, those camps now on an annual basis serve more than 500 local churches and more than 10,000 young people. And that's just it each year now. And so it's been neat to see how God's used this ministry in that way, kind of as a ministry multiplier of helping support the ministry of local churches all over the world. With camp, we get to use the unique benefits of Christian camping. One is that camp provides a platform for relationships, connecting teenagers with godly young adults who want to invest in them and show the love of Christ to them. Another opportunity of camp is just that opportunity for fun with a purpose, that we're playing games and we're having those activities, but we're serious about what that does. It builds bridges and it breaks down barriers and provides just a clear opportunity for communication to develop, and it builds a relationship so that young people are open to hearing the Word of God. Camp also gets people away from daily distractions. Anywhere you go in the world, teens and even adults have good things they can do at home and bad things they can do at home. They've got routines that they get into, and camp just pulls them away from that to a place where they can focus on the Word of God. And even a distraction like technology, a lot of times we think of that as an American thing, and it certainly can be, but we were in a place not long ago where 60% of the population has access to regular electricity in their home. So what percent would you think have a cell phone? Maybe all those people, all 60%? How about 90%? So they may not have electricity in their home, but they've got a cell phone, and so they'll charge it with a battery, or they'll plug it in when they're in town. They've got the technology, and it can just be a distraction really anywhere in the world. And camp brings people away from their normal routine into an environment to hear the Word of God. And camp is about sharing the Word of God in a variety of ways, and so connecting young people with a concentrated immersion in the Word of God. Large group preaching times, small group counselor-guided discussions, and then each counselor is looking for an opportunity to communicate one-on-one with each of his or her campers, saying, hey, what has God been teaching you this week? How can I help you take your next spiritual step? Sometimes these campers come to camp with really no Christian background whatsoever. Maybe they're from a Hindu home or a Muslim home, and just introducing them to Jesus and showing the hope that He gives. Sometimes they're from a church and they've grown up in church and they know the Lord and they love the Lord, and they just, how can I encourage you? What is God teaching you this week? So helping them take their next spiritual step. And then opportunities for one to have just individual Bible study built into the schedule. Maybe it's the first time in their life when one of these teenagers has sat down with the Bible themselves and read it and thought, hey, what does this mean for my life? Answered a few questions, and maybe it's the first time where they've studied God's Word on their own. And maybe it's the first time they've done that 2 days in a row or 3 days in a row, and it can be the beginning of a pattern of Bible study for them. With Camps Abroad, we're always working with local leaders. So this can be missionaries or national pastors, but then we'll give instruction, model it for them, but eventually we want to phase out. We don't want to stay there forever. And so we're always working with local leaders, local churches. And this works. An example of that from South Africa. Here we've got Ati and Luke. Ati came to a camp that we did in December of 2018, and he did not come to know the Lord at camp, though some of his friends did, but through camp he was then connected with a local church. He started attending regularly. Now, the challenge for him is that he's deaf, so he would come to church but couldn't understand everything that was going on, but he knew the people loved him and cared about him. So he'd come to church. Well, Luke learned that Ati could write in very good English, and so they went back and forth on a whiteboard for over an hour, Luke sharing the gospel and asking and answering questions, and Ati came to know the Lord in February after camp had ended in December. While Ati was consistent in church, he was then baptized that October. He was back at a follow-up camp we did December of 2019. He's been connected with the group ever since. Now, if our model had been, hey, Port Elizabeth, South Africa, it looks strategic, a lot of young people, let's go hold an event. Okay, fine, you know, have some preaching, but then what about when we leave? Since there were local churches that had invited us and said, we want to use camp to reach our young people, can you help us? When we leave, they're doing the follow-up. It's already in place. A similar situation in Bangladesh. The pastor there, it was all Bangladeshi national pastors, he was taking us back to the airport, and he said some of the campers came as far as 20 hours to get to camp. And so they're from all over the country. Public transportation takes a long time to get around. He was sharing that they were aware of three Hindu girls in particular that they'd been praying for, some of which came to know the Lord. Some of the Hindu girls did not come to know the Lord. And so, you know, kids from Hindu, Muslim backgrounds, they're on their way home. We're headed back to the U.S. But he said, I'm already in touch with the pastors in those communities so that there's follow-up in place on the ground when they go home. Again, if we'd said, hey, Bangladesh, a lot of young people, let's go hold an event and go back to the U.S., who knows what would have come of it? Can God use that? Sure. But since we're working with ministries that want to continue this, God's blessed that and allowed it to make a difference for a lot of young people. Camps Abroad is global and mobile. We receive requests from all over the world, and we can go just about anywhere because you can hold camp out of just about any property where you can gather them. We can fit games into any sort of space and be creative with all of that. So in our time with Camps Abroad, Rachel and I have been to China twice. We've been to Bangladesh twice, Myanmar, South Africa twice. Summer of 2019, I was in Vietnam and the Philippines. And then earlier this year, we were in Kenya in April, Poland in July, Mexico last month, and Dominican Republic last week. And Lord willing, 2 weeks from today, we head to Zambia and then Uganda at the end of the year. So we'll just keep going with that. We've got some goals as well. This is a bit of where Camps Abroad has been. We'd like to increase the number of international trips by about 30%. So if 2018-2019 was able to serve 10,000 young people, we'd also like to double the number of campers we're reaching annually in the next 5 years. So if 2018-2019 was able to serve 10,000 young people, we'd like to see that close to 20,000 within the next couple of years, and we believe the numbers are there, the opportunities are there. Perhaps it's slightly ambitious, but we're okay with that. We believe it's a godly ambition, and it is possible. And then we've also had some opportunities to serve missionary families with camp for the missionary kids, MK camps. So missionary kids grow up often as U.S. citizens, but they're living in, say, Peru. And so they're a little bit more Peruvian because that's where they grew up. That's where most of their friends are. But they're not quite Peruvian because, you know, they don't quite fit in there. Their family's a little bit different. They've got friends back in the U.S., but they don't fit in there either. And so they feel like third culture kids. They grow up in a unique situation and with a lot of goodbyes. And sometimes they think they're weird for not fitting in, for not understanding all these different situations. And so serving missionary families, having camps where the missionary kids can come together and have preaching just that encourages them in their particular areas has been a huge blessing. The families have responded well to that, and so that's something that Camps Abroad has been able to serve missionary families with that as well. But none of this happens without our partners, and so we would love it if you would pray for us, partner with us in prayer, and then as God provides opportunities for financial support, and then if you would keep in touch. We've got some prayer cards on the back table, some wristbands as well. And then you can grab one of those, pray for us as the Lord brings us to your mind, And then we can also send emails with prayer updates. Financial support, we're currently at 70% on our support. Earlier this year, we were at about 100% of our initial target. No, don't get scared, okay? This is not bad. This is good, okay? When we started with Camps Abroad, one of my big questions in my mind was, it's a lot of short-term relationships with camp, right? That's fine. It's by design, but you invest in somebody for a week, and you go home. What about the long-term relationships? And Matt, our director, said, well, that's why it's going to be important for you to be involved with your local church long-term, that you're really invested there. He said, but initially, we would like for you to live at the Wilds to be, it keeps your costs down, it helps you really get the feel for what's going on, but then you can move off the campsite close to your church at some point. Well, this spring we moved off the campsite close to our church, and so that raised our expenses, and so the Wilds said, hey, you're going to have to raise some more support. So we are back to 70. We didn't lose any support through that. So I didn't mean to scare you, but that was a lot of talking for one slide. Let's keep going. So as God provides opportunities, we'd love it if you would partner with us in that. And if you say that was interesting, but it was way too fast, I'm sorry. I can start over and just go through it more slowly. You want? No? Okay. Campsabroad.org has it at your own pace. You can click through, learn some information there. If you say it could have been interesting, but you didn't have enough pictures, again, I apologize. My fault. Facebook has pictures. You can follow Camps Abroad on Facebook or Instagram if that's your thing. We also have emails. Let me explain. We've got an email that comes out 3 times a year maybe with a newsletter, just the big stuff. We also have prayer updates that come out once a month with, again, the big stuff, but a little more in the loop. And then when we're on the ground overseas, we try to send out an email to maybe 3 saying, hey, here's what God's doing at this camp. Hey, we just finished up training. Hey, camp's starting. We've got campers arriving. We've already got 76 campers and only 74 beds. And so we're making more beds right now so that they don't have to sleep on the ground tomorrow. True story from South Africa, but on-site updates is where you'd get that kind of in-the-moment stuff. So 3 separate emails. You could sign up for any of those or all of those. A third of the world's population is currently under the age of 20. Now, that's not true in the U.S. As a general rule, most communities, maybe virtually no communities, have a population this young in the U.S. But it is true around the world that life expectancy is not as long. There's an explosion of youth. And so reaching young people is a huge opportunity. That's 2.5 billion young people spread all over the world. 2019, I was in Vietnam. And in Vietnam, working with a local pastor there, a Vietnamese man, he said, when we share the gospel in Vietnam, we have to start with there is only one God. Okay? So coming from a polytheistic, ancestor worship, Buddhist type of culture with some variety in there, he said, we have to start with there's only one God. Okay. Good. He knows that. Now I know that too, and now you know that too. Straight from Vietnam to the Philippines, where in that particular area it was predominantly Roman Catholic as a background, the kids come believing that there's only one God. They believe in Jesus. They believe that Jesus did something for them, and I'm like, hey, this is great. They believe that Jesus did something for them, and they've got to figure out the rest. They've got to be good enough to somehow earn God's forgiveness. And they grow up with the weight and burden of always having to be good enough for God to accept them, but knowing that they're not quite there. And so for counselors to be able to say, hey, well, let's look at what the Bible says. What does God say about forgiveness? What does God say about grace? Was very liberating for so many of these young people. And so here's what just a few of them were saying from that camp there in the Philippines. This week I learned that Jesus alone saves. Another, I was not very religious. Our culture is not the same as what I learn here. This place is different. I used to worship God without the Bible. And without humility, I am now a daughter of our Savior. This week I got saved. All you have to do is believe, repent, and trust. I used to be angry at God for taking my dad. I didn't think I ever deserved God's forgiveness. This week I realized that God can still use me in a special way. When I go home, I will share the gospel with my family, regardless of what they say. I need to introduce them to Jesus, and I know I have my friends at my back. Another, I didn't read the Bible, but here I was learning the Bible. I told my counselor of a big sin. Would God really forgive me? I have accepted Christ, and now I know that I can confess to God any sin, no matter how big or small. This week my friend asked me if I was truly saved. I realized I am a sinner. I don't know the Bible. I never memorized a verse, but now I am 100% sure of my salvation, and I will be sharing the gospel with my family when I go home today. A counselor said this: "We have prayed and asked God for many things, including the weather and safety. God has prepared the harvest, and now he's bringing the harvest." And this is true. We pray about a lot of different things, health needs, we pray about the weather, we pray about safety, and that is all appropriate. We also pray that God would work in hearts. We pray that God would save souls, and God is at work in hearts, and God is saving souls. And so as we have opportunities to share the gospel with people, God is at work, and people need the hope that is found in Jesus Christ alone. And so this is the mission field that God has called us to, these young people spread out in different communities and different ways around the world. And so thanks for welcoming us. Thanks for even remembering us and allowing us to come and share about this ministry.
All right, here's what we're going to do. We are going to have a hymn. We'll all stand. If you want to stand now, stretch your legs. And then after the hymn, we're going to have an offering. We'll just have an offertory played. And if you want to give, those of you that are online know that you can give online. But if you want to give your tithes and offerings, it'll be up front. And we're going to take a love offering for the Endeans, and it's in the back. There's a plate in the back that has, you know, love offering for the Endeans, that will be for them. So if you want to give during that time, during the offering, you can do that.
And then after we're done the offering, then we'll have the Endeans come and minister in music, and then Tim will open the word to us. So, Dave?
All right, start to hymn 115, Love Lifted Me, hymn 115.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to him I give, ever to him I cling. In his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true, merits its soul's best songs. Faithful, loving service to him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger, look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, Philos's will obey. He your savior wants to be, to save today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Amen. This time we'll have our offertory played as we take our offering. Let's bow in word of prayer before the offering. Dear Lord, we just thank you for your many blessings, Lord. We thank you for your provision. We thank you for your grace and mercy, Lord. We ask that you would continue to provide for this church, Lord. Bless us in all that we do, Lord. We ask this in your precious name. Amen.
Hear my humble cry.
All right, turn in your Bibles, if you would, to the book of Ecclesiastes. No, for real, yeah, Ecclesiastes. Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes is a book that I think resonates with many people. Certainly resonates with me, resonates with many others, because it's written by Solomon, a man who had everything life could offer at his fingertips. As Americans, often, we kind of have everything life could offer at our fingertips. Around the world, we meet a lot of different people. We meet a lot of people that want to come to America. Okay, we know, that's great. I mean, we love America. We think America is among the top 200 countries in the world. Actually, I would say maybe the top one. We like America a lot, okay? And there's a lot of people that want to come to America. I remember being in Bangladesh talking with a young man, and he said, oh, I would love to come to America. So, well, that's great. You know, if you could come to America, I think that would be awesome. I think there are a lot of things you would really enjoy about it. He said, I would love to come to America and meet all the Christians. I mean, America is a Christian nation. Think of where he's coming from. Bangladesh, it's a Muslim nation. 89.9% Muslim, 9.5% Hindu. By my math, and I'm not great at math, that does not leave a lot of other people. So he's a Christian in Bangladesh. I would love to come to America and meet all the Christians. Well, I think I would love to introduce you to a lot of Christians in America, some wonderful people I know, but I think you'd be disappointed if you thought you were coming to America and everyone was a Christian. Other people want to come to America just for the life it could offer them. And sometimes you're very sympathetic to that, with the situation maybe that they grow up in, the situation that they're coming from. But if they think that America could make them happy, again, I think they would be disappointed. And we know this. We know this from our own experience. And I'm not just talking about America or anything else in particular. I am saying that we know that there are things in life that sometimes we set our sight on and say, wow, if I could have that, then I would be happy. But then we also know from our own experience that that's just not true. When's the last time maybe you got that pay raise, or you got that next thing in life, you got that next job, you got whatever it was, maybe you achieved some goal, and it was great. Maybe you could even honestly say from your heart that you thank the Lord for that. Great. But does that thing make you happy? We know that there are poor people in this world who are as happy as anybody else, who are maybe happier than most other people. It's not money that made them happy or the lack of money. We know rich people who are no happier than anybody else, and we probably also know rich people who are perhaps joyful in the Lord, okay? And the truth is that our satisfaction in life, our joy in life, cannot be tied to material things. Material things cannot satisfy us. And so Solomon, perhaps among the wealthiest men to ever live, blessed with wisdom by God, wisest man, said wisdom can't make him happy, money can't make him happy. If you read the book of Ecclesiastes, if you know the history of Solomon, he had more money than anybody could ever spend, more wisdom than anybody else alive, more women than any man could ever love. He had the greatest accomplishments, the work projects, the career, you add it all up together. He had everything the world could offer, and he said, you know what, none of it can satisfy. Nothing in this world can satisfy. And so in the book of Ecclesiastes, he's kind of recounting a lot of this and saying, you know what, you can go for this, and whatever joy God gives you in that, great, enjoy that. It's a gift from God, but in and of itself, if that's what you're living for, it's vanity, it's worthless. It just disappears. It's only for this life, and is it even for that? And so at the end of Ecclesiastes, turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 12, we kind of get his summary. Certain things in life can satisfy, but it's not the things of this world. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, look with me at verse 1. He says, remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. And then he talks a little bit about getting old. He gives some warnings. And then go all the way to the end of the chapter, verse 13. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. And there's something that resonates here. We have a God who has created us in a certain way so that things in this life cannot satisfy. Only He can satisfy. And so maybe you're here today and you are deeply satisfied with your relationship with God. You have walked with God for many years. It's been the best thing that has ever happened to you. Maybe you're here and you say, you know, I want that to be me. It's not that that's not me, but maybe sometimes you feel as though a sense of purpose is a little bit missing. You feel stuck in a rut, maybe sometimes. You wonder whether your daily activities have eternal value. Or maybe you don't think that way in particular. Maybe the way you use your time, your energy, your money, whether that honors God, well, it's not a huge deal to you. You'll give God a certain amount of your time, a certain amount of your life, but you've got your own goals and dreams that you want to accomplish. Well, regardless of which category we would fall into, or somewhere in between, or outside of all those categories, I believe these verses have words of both encouragement for us and words of warning as well. Solomon points us to thinking back about our Creator. We have been created by God. If God's our Creator, then we have an authority. We have someone who has designed us in a certain way. But he points us to thinking about our Creator right now. Remember Him now. There's a time coming where you won't have the same opportunities you have right now. There's a time coming where he's really being kind of blunt, saying you're going to get older. There's a time coming where you just don't have the same people in your life. You don't have the same opportunities. You don't have the same energy. What are you going to do right now for your Creator? And he's especially talking to young people. He says it right there. Remember your Creator in the days of your youth. And so for young people, from a human perspective, they've got their whole life ahead of them, right? So, you know, you're 16 years old, you're 20 years old, you're 30 years old. God may give you another 50 years, 60 years. What are you going to do with it? You can live, from a human perspective, you can live all that time for yourself. Get whatever you can get out of it. But remember, there's a God in heaven who created you. He's your authority. He's designed you with a specific purpose. And it's not to just live for yourself. So these words are addressed especially to young people. And so there might be some here today who are saying, well, I think a lot of the days of my youth are behind me. Well, apparently God has given each of us a little bit more time. We're here tonight, so I think the question for each of us is, what will we do with the days that God has given us? We can say, oh, this is for young people. They've got 50 years ahead of them. A lot of my life's behind me. Well, do young people have 50 years ahead of them? Maybe. We know young people who have gone to the Lord far younger than us. Or they've gone into eternity far younger than us. What will you do with the time that God has given you? There's a time coming where you won't have the opportunities that you have today. The opportunities, the energy, the people in your life that you have next week. And so a lot of times as we talk about missions, and we can talk about Bangladesh and the dominant Muslim population there, or we can talk about Myanmar and the Buddhist population there, or Vietnam and the communism and ancestor worship, or China and the atheism and agnosticism. We can talk about all this stuff, and it's interesting, it's intriguing, it's easy to talk about. But our backyards, our next-door neighbors, the people that we interact with on a day-to-day basis are often just as lost. They don't know the Lord. They don't know Jesus. They don't have any clear sense of the gospel because no one's ever told them. Or maybe someone has told them about the gospel before. They've heard about it. But it's just been a seed that's been planted. And God might use you to water that. And so God uses us in our own communities to reach the people around us. And missions, yes, it is global. Sharing the gospel is something that should go to all parts of the earth, but it starts close to home, sharing the gospel with our communities. We have opportunities that God has given us right now. Life is short. Time goes fast. And so what are we going to do with the days that God has given us? And these verses give us encouragement. Solomon, in verse 13, he says, let's look at this, the conclusion of everything that he's discussed throughout this whole book. Fear God and keep His commandments. There are so many things that pull our attention. There are so many things that you can chase with your time and your energy. And there's certain things that God has given us to enjoy, and that's fine, okay? But what is your focus in life? Fear God and keep His commandments. This is something that you can do exactly where you are. You don't have to be the missionary or the pastor or the Christian school teacher or the pastor's wife. You can fear God and keep His commandments as an accountant. You can fear God and keep His commandments as a food service provider, as a landscaper. You can fear God and keep His commandments as a stay-at-home mom. You can fear God and keep His commandments wherever He puts you. And Solomon says, look, I had it all, And what matters? Fearing God and keeping his commandments. And there's people all over the world who, in a certain sense, try for this exact thing. A fear of a God, keeping a moral code. I mean, does that sound like a lot of people we might know? Are there people around the world who have a fear of a God? Yeah, billions of them. Just take Islam. Bangladesh, 89.9% Muslim. Do Muslims have a fear of a God? Yeah. It's not a God who loves them. Even in their own mind, it's not a God who loves them. It's not a God who gives them hope. It's not a God who they respond to with joy because of his mercy and grace. It's quite different from the God we know, the true God of the Bible, a God who loves us, who has sent his son, Jesus Christ, because he loves us, not because we deserved it, not because we earned it, but in spite of ourselves, God sent us Jesus Christ. We get to fear a God like that. And what a privilege and hope it is to know that we have a God who reigns in heaven. And when everything in the world might look like it's falling apart, it's not. In a human sense, sure, it's falling apart, but there's a God in heaven who reigns, a God in heaven who raises up kings, rulers, politicians, evil kings, evil rulers like Nebuchadnezzar, and then removes them. The Mesopotamian world of the time may have looked like it was falling apart. God was in control through all of it. 21st century America, or 21st century the world, might look like it's falling apart. God's in control. Is this a message that people need? Yeah, there's a God in heaven who is in control. There's a God in heaven who reigns. But he doesn't just reign in an abstract, transcendental way where he doesn't care about us. He doesn't care about individuals. God reigns, but he cares about individuals. Your neighbor is loved and cared for by God as he reigns from heaven over everything. He cares about the individual. This is a message of hope that people can have and they need, but who's going to tell them? Are there people around the world who have a moral code that they try to keep? Yeah, billions of them. I would say this is my experience from neighbors that I grew up with. I grew up in a Christian home. Parents love the Lord. And so as I had opportunities to share the gospel with neighbors growing up, I would say the pretty standard response that I would get is, well, I think if my good works outweigh my bad works, that God will accept me. Right? They're trying to be a good person, okay? Lots of nice neighbors. I'm glad for that. I'm glad we had nice neighbors. But are their good works ever going to outweigh their bad works? According to Scripture, no, it can't happen. God doesn't accept us based on our own goodness. He accepts us in Jesus Christ. And so there are billions of people around the world who are just trying to be good people. Take Buddhism, for example. Myanmar, a country we've had some ministry in, is 88% Buddhist. Buddhists, their idea of eternal life, so to speak, is what we would probably think of as annihilation. They wouldn't describe it quite that way. They would describe it more as a cease from feeling pain, right? But cease from feeling pain, also cease from feeling anything, also cease from being conscious of anything, cease from existing as you know it, just becoming one with everything and nothing with nothing and just whoo, gone. That is why they keep their moral code. Is our keeping of God's commandments a little bit different from that? Yeah, we keep commandments not as though we're going to earn favor with God or achieve some sort of enlightenment or ceasing to exist. We have a hope that people of this world don't have. We keep God's commandments because he loves us and because we love him in response for what he has done for us. Fear God, keeps commandments. This is what really matters in life. It's different from what the world offers. It's a hope that's different from what the world offers. And just in case people say, you know, I'm doing fine. I've got it. I'm fine. We also have a warning here that not only is God our creator, not only does he give us hope in life, tell us our duty, so to speak, God also is judge. God cares about how we live, and if God will bring every work into judgment, then our relationship with him is really important. That are we comfortable standing before God as our judge on our own terms? Well, it doesn't matter on our terms, it's on God's terms. You know, well, I think my good works outweigh my bad works. And we're not the ones bringing ourselves into judgment. God brings every work into judgment, whether it be good or whether it be evil. And so even focusing this on believers, God cares about how we live. God notices. God notices when you take the time to do something kind for a church member that no one else ever notices. God notices. God brings every work into judgment, whether it be good or whether it be evil. God notices when you take that extra time with a neighbor, with an unsaved neighbor, with an unsaved coworker, to be that good testimony, to maybe even risk some of your reputation by witnessing. God notices, even when nobody else notices. And we have the opportunity to live a life that's not worthless, exactly where God has put us, and exactly the people God has put us around, because what really matters in life is not achieving that next career status, although we can spend all of our time on that. It's not achieving that next tax bracket, although we can spend all of our time on that. What matters is fearing God, keeping his commandments, and we can do that exactly where he has placed us. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Thank you for giving us hope in Jesus Christ, hope for us, hope for the world. Help us to be faithful to share that hope with other people. Thank you that you give us opportunities exactly where we are to make a difference, to make a difference in the lives of unbelievers, to make a difference in the lives of believers as we encourage one another, as we uphold one another in prayer and speak your truth at the right time in the right way. Help us to be faithful to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand. We're going to close in song. And I'm going to ask Rachel and Tim if you go in the back, and they'll be by their display. Make sure you sign up for the prayer letter and keep this precious couple in prayer. What a blessing. Amen. I appreciate them so much. Thank you.
All right, let's turn to hymn 181, Wonderful Words of Life, hymn 181. Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the Blessed One gives to all wonderful words of life. Sinnerless to the loving call, wonderful words of life. Also freely given, wooing us to heaven. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Sweetly echo the gospel call, wonderful words of life. Offer pardon and peace to all, wonderful words of life. Jesus, only Savior, sanctify forever. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Amen. You're dismissed.